When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him, and he began to speak and taught them, saying,
"Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven."
Well, we can't read that one very well, so I'm going to say this. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted.
Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my name's sake. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you.
Amen. And thanks to Patricia Stewart for those beautiful slides and giving us the images that go with these beautiful words. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, blessed are we, your people, who have given great instruction to through the voice of Jesus. We thank you for these beautiful words and for your holy scripture as it gives us that true wisdom that we need in life. And so this morning we pray that our meditations, when we take in these words of wisdom upon our hearts, that whatever comes through ourselves and our bodies and our hands and hearts will be pleasing and acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
I remember fondly when my children were learning to ride their bicycles. I was blessed with three opportunities to help three children learn to ride bikes. Maybe some of you have taught children, others, to ride bicycles. It's quite an experience, isn't it? It takes a lot of patience and a lot of guidance. Even when we start with those little wheels that hang off the rear wheel, the training wheels, it only goes so far. Then the children are nagging us, "Come on, Dad, Mom, take off these wheels. I want to get on the two-wheeler on my own." And if you have any experience in doing this, you remember, well, okay, fine, if you think you're ready, we'll do that. We'll start on the soft surfaces of the lawn, and we'll put you on the bike, and of course they pedal about three times, or if they're lucky, three times, and all, poof, they're on the ground, and sometimes they're all upset with themselves, and start crying, and it's more of a hurt ego than it is a bruised knee, but they get back up on the bike with our encouragement. We hold that seat, and we keep going. We practice day after day or weekend after weekend, and sooner or later, that kid is able to do what? They're able to pedal, and they take off on their own, and they're a little wobbly when they do that, and they'll go so far, then they'll go kaplunk, and they'll get back up on their own, right? And they get back on that bike. I got it. I got it. And they'll keep going and keep going. You know, it's a great thing to be able to teach my son Joshua how to ride his bike. The only thing about Joshua and riding his bike is that he mastered very quickly how to pedal and go forward. What he never really mastered until a little later in life was how to put on the brakes. So Josh could go for a long time and so forth. And I'd be saying, "Josh, you gotta stop it. You just keep pedaling." And for me, that became a real image of life, because sometimes we just keep pedaling. We just don't know how to put on the brakes. We don't have that wisdom. We just think we got to keep going and going. Well, God tells us you got to put on the brakes sometime and take a rest. Well, after teaching kids how to ride bikes, you know, maybe you've had the same experience. You've taught kids how to drive a car. Yeah? Anybody done that? Or taught anybody how to drive a car? You know, you need to really be patient with yourself and with other people, but you also have to know yourself well. Because the people that you love the most, you probably don't want to teach how to drive. Does that, you agree with that?
Yes.
You know, the people that you love with, when you want them to learn how to drive, but you don't want to be in that seat next to them when they're learning how to drive. Most recently, it was just a few years ago, taught Shira, my youngest daughter, how to drive. And, you know, we're blessed here in East Hartford. If you go over to the old movie theater, on any given day, you're going to find a lot of people learning how to drive. Some people even set up these cones and practice backing up and stuff. And I remember taking Shira over there, and it was something like, you know, getting her on the bike. I got her in the driver's seat. She was so excited. Matter of fact, I think she was more interested in controlling the radio than the steering wheel, which was a real problem. I want this song. I said, whoa, pay attention to where you're going. I'll take care of the radio. But she would be driving, and she would do fairly well. But there would come a time that I had to just let go. And I had a hard time doing that. You know, they're driving, and all of a sudden, they're maybe going too fast. And all of a sudden, you're thrusting your foot to that imaginary brake that's on the passenger side. Have you done that? It's like, oh my gosh, put the brakes on. And, you know, luckily, we're in the parking lot or in a safe place, and they figure out how to do that. It's not like riding a bike. They've got to learn on themselves. They've got to gain that wisdom that allows them to experience life and the situation and the conditions and all the things that go with driving. Teaching the skills of Christian life, teaching the skills of how to be a Christian, must also come from certain people. Whether you're teaching someone to ride a bike or teaching them to drive or some other skill, you've got to be a gifted person for that. It's not just something that you take lightly. The same thing about learning to be a Christian. Someone has to be there to help you separate the difference between earthly wisdom and divine wisdom, holy wisdom and just everyday wisdom. Being a Sunday school teacher is one of those individuals. Whether you're a Christian educator for young children or for adults, you're a special person. And I'm so grateful for my Sunday school teachers, and I hope you are too. For those people who took the time, the volunteer time, to teach you how to get up on your feet and to move forward as a Christian. It takes very special skills and gifts. Patience. I was not a very obedient Sunday school teacher. I liked the taste of that glue. My Sunday school teacher, God bless her, she was here today, Florence Palmer, we said, yeah, Gary was... He was there every Sunday, but we couldn't keep the glue out of his mouth. Back in the day, they made this kind of sweet, flowery type of glue, you know? It was just, we had all kinds of fun growing up. And our Sunday school teachers, God bless them, they were with us all the way. You've got to be a special person to have that wisdom, that divine wisdom that teaches you not only the skills, but the call of a Christian. And we must give thanks to God, not only for our Christian educators, but for one another. You heard last Sunday, if you were here for the baptism, that we all have a responsibility to those that we bring into the family of Christ, whether they're baptized Christians or those that join our community for whatever time. We all have a responsibility to be Christian educators through the example that we give off in life. For we all have wisdom that God has imparted to us, has shared with us. We come into the world, this raw material, these beautiful blobs of humanity, they come into the world, and it's up to us, with God's help and guidance, to impart, to do the human work that is necessary to create a Christian here on earth, a disciple of Christ, as we call it. We are all Christian educators in one way or another. Don't ever forget that. The content of the apostles' letters, when you look at the apostles' letters, you will find that they're much about Christian education. What does it mean to be a Christian? Now, these letters were written to churches that were very, very new, and they're very complex. They had all kinds of cultural differences and diversity, and there were a group of people that were coming together in very different contexts, whether it was the context of being a Jew or a Gentile. It was very difficult for Paul and the other apostles to keep their churches on track of becoming what they feel God was calling them to be. And so they would write these letters from a distance, and maybe we would call them today information that would come as a form of distant learning, online learning. And back in the day, we called them correspondence courses. You would be at home, the materials would be shipped out to you, you would study, take the test, mail them back, you would get a grade at the end of the correspondence course. And by the way, these courses are still very important for those that are incarcerated. There's tons of programs that those that are incarcerated are using to advance their education and for preparation for being back out in the community. When the Apostle Paul or others learned that a church was having problems or that church leaders were going astray, they would get together and they would read this letter that Paul or the other apostle would have written. Now, the letters were written in the form most familiar to the readers, whether it was, in most cases, the apostles were writing in the form that a Greek scholar would write a letter. So they have a special form. And we're not going to talk about the formation of the letter, so beginning with the greeting and the thanksgiving and so on, and all the different parts. We want to talk this morning about the content of the letters. You see, we're having a problem with messaging these days. And we have to, as Christians, pay attention to content over form. Today, we seem to be paying more attention to content. A great example would be how politicians, and particularly our new president, is using Twitter to provide hints of policy in his personal opinion in the world. Whether you agree with it or not, I'm not talking about any opinion of myself, right? I'm talking about the form. We've got to be careful about the forms that we use to communicate. And as Christians, we need to be careful as well how we communicate with one another, because we want to make sure that the focus is on the content, the message. And so when these letters were written, they were written in a way that, again, followed in the patterns and the customs of those who culturally were able to read and write, but they also had this very, very important message that was inside them. Now, at the time that the letters were written, they were competing educators. There were different forms of teaching, different groups of individuals who felt that they had an incredible amount of wisdom. And they were able to speak really well. They were trained in the gift and the art of rhetoric. This is the Greek way of learning. A lot of memorization, a lot of great speeches, a lot of different ways of putting together content. And so the competing educators were proud of their skills, and they became members of Christian communities, and they started to bring their skills, which we want in church life today. We want people to bring their gifts and their skills to build up the body of Christ. But what was happening back in the time of Paul is that these great orators and these people that had the gift of rhetoric and the gift of wisdom, what they felt was wisdom, were trying to impart what they thought was the way to go. And what was happening is that the church was kind of, in our terms, getting off the rails. And Paul and the other apostles were trying to bring folks back on track by sending these letters out. So take a look at all the letters. You'll see that there's oftentimes they're trying to impart a particular message that is a correction or encouragement or a moment of clarity, helping Christians understand through education and prayer, where they ought to be in the time that they were living and serving as Christians. And so the important thing to know about this letter that we referred to this morning that Kenny shared with us from 1 Corinthians is that the focus of these educators, these folks, these men that were trained in rhetoric and felt they had a lot of wisdom, was that they were getting away from Jesus Christ, the message of the gospel. And they were more interested in the way that things could be delivered. The messaging service, if you will. They were more interested in getting themselves up in the place of high honor in speaking than bringing themselves down to the message that Jesus wanted to impart to all the disciples so they could understand what it meant to have true wisdom. The message from St. Paul, the message for us this morning is that God has revealed to us a certain kind of wisdom, and that we don't want to miss out on that wisdom. Nobody wants to go without the information that they need in any aspect of life. And as a Christian, you want to make sure you understand the wisdom that's being imparted and revealed to us through Christ Jesus. And that you don't just like, oh, well, pastor said this or pastor said that, so that's what we're supposed to be. No, you have to be very careful. We pastors, we have like, you know, some of us have a gift to gab and to preach or whatever, or to talk or teach, but you have to be careful because we are too limited and can be fragile and can misunderstand. So together, we look at these words of wisdom from Scripture so to make sure that we have this ongoing conversation and dialogue about what does it mean to be a Christian in the world today and what wisdom is being revealed to us through Christ Jesus. Because we're all in this together. So Paul, really from on in his life as an apostle. And early in our reading this morning, it is clear that some were thinking of other things than the saving act of Jesus Christ. Somehow they had gotten away from the central fact that God so loved the world, Gospel of John, that he gave his only begotten Son so that whoever believeth in him would have life eternal, be saved. They were getting away from the fact that God had done this amazing thing with Jesus and the cross. They were getting away from the fact that Jesus died for us, for them, for all of the world. And they were getting away from the fact that the true understanding and the wisdom that God is trying to impart to us is that you may think you're smart, but I will show you that you do not fully understand how smart you are or how you're not smart enough to see how God so loves you that even through the foolishness of the cross, the wisdom of God is being imparted to you whether you see it or not, no matter how smart you think you may be. The question was, well, how could such an act of God make sense? How could God, if God so truly is love, make this decision to give God's only Son up to the cross? It just sounds crazy to these folks back then. And they started to look at other things other than what God's saving act was and the wisdom that they had, and they started to mix up, and folks were going off in all different directions, but not in the direction of the cross. And so verses 27 and 29 of 1 Corinthians chapter 1 read, and this is for me the core, and I hope for you is important too. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. Now, if you were back in the time, one of those trained individuals who could speak and preach and teach and had all this gift of rhetoric, you would not want to hear that. That God chose something foolish to shame you. But it wasn't an issue of making you feel low or less worthy. For God chose what is weak, says the letter. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce nothing things that are, to reduce to nothing things that are, so that no one might boast in the presence of God. And that was what was happening. Those that had the gifts of rhetoric and the gifts of wisdom were starting to say, look at me. Look at me, how great and how smart I am. Again, distracting folks, the people that they were responsible to as church leaders, from the core matter at hand. The saving act of God in Christ Jesus, the cross. In other words, Paul is telling the so-called well-spoken wise guys and their students to hold on for a moment. If you're going to be a Christian, you're missing it. You're missing the point. God is teaching us something. They needed to hear this. That God was teaching something to them. And the apostles did the best that they could to get this message out, that the teaching was completely different than what they thought they needed to learn. And that the teaching itself was Christ Jesus. And it was coming through Christ Jesus. And that the biggest lesson for humanity was to understand that God so loved the world that Jesus Christ through the cross was making a whole new picture visible. And in that picture, you look at these strange things that are happening. And all of a sudden, the mighty and the powerful, they're down low. And those who think they're so wise aren't so wise. We heard that from Mary when she spoke and sang her beautiful song. This low handmaid speaking about what God was going to do through her son, soon to be born, to bring up those that are at the bottom and to lower those that are at the top. And Jesus would go on and teach that and model that throughout his earthly life and ministry. God is really teaching us something different through Jesus Christ in the world. God is really teaching us something different on how we can live our lives every day. Jesus is making this message clear and simple for us in the teachings found in the gospel. You read them with me, the Beatitudes. They're one of the best lessons that you can read and study to understand this upside-down, reshaping lesson from God. Those words where promises are made. Promises are made to those that are in really desperate situations. Promises such as, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Promises such as, blessed those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Situations and conditions that are not good. Human suffering. But in this message, in this upside down world of Christianity, where wisdom is imparted through Jesus Christ, when you look through the cross, you can see that, yes, even though situations are as desperate and difficult as they are, when we look through the cross of Jesus Christ, we see a different world, even on the face of it. It looks so desperate. But when you look through the cross, you can see that God had come through, even in the most torturous and terrible experience of God's only Son being crucified, put to death. We can look through there and see that God has not forgotten us and has given us this gift to remember that in all that we suffer and experience through, we will get through to the other side, and there's this promise on the other side. Now, it's a hard lesson to hold on to in a world that's spinning in so many directions. We wonder, what's going to happen? All these different changes. And for some, it's extremely frightening. And for others, it's the way we need to go. We're not all on the same page. But the church has got to be on the same page. And the same page is that page that comes to us leaf after leaf when we go through Scripture where God has made a promise to be with us. And through all times. And to give us wisdom and to shape and form us. So that we can be those people that we need to be, whatever the conditions are. God is completely teaching us something very different. He makes this so clear through the Beatitudes and through other gospel lessons. That out of the lesson that we learn that God promises God's people a way of salvation through all situations and conditions. Even the most unexpected situations and circumstances, God has promised to take the raw material. And this life that we live is so raw sometimes. This life that we share together, He promises to take this raw material of life and to make it holy. Can you believe that? That out of the circumstances, situations that we're in, no matter what it is, whatever you're living with, whatever you're dealing with, that if we believe that God is present with us and accompany us through all this, it will become holy. And that might will say, you may be saying, well, that doesn't make any sense. That's what sounds like foolishness. That the suffering and difficulty and the challenges of life that will become holy. Well, how do they become? How is that ever going to become holy? And I would suggest to you and I would ask you to contemplate and to believe and to pray over that God is, you know, you're not driving this car by yourself. You've seen those license plates, right? God is my co-pilot. Well, sometimes that is really true. In life experience, when you see yourself going through a red light and nothing happens. But that's a license plate. That's a true saying in circumstance sometimes. But when we're looking at these situations and in life, conditions that are such raw material of life, and we're wondering where is the holiness in life and where's God in the midst of all this? We've got to look through that cross again and say, if God is so willing to put Jesus in a condition and situation where his life is taken for us, then there must be some way that God will get me through my Calvary too. Well, God will take care of me and get me through whatever I'm going through. And bring me to that next moment of joy. Because you know it follows, right? That tomb was empty. It was joy. And Jesus became visible and returned to his disciples and shared life with them. And started to teach them through the gifts of the Holy Spirit how to take the raw material of life and make it holy. And so while circumstances and situations of our lives, our country, and our world make sudden changes, making us want to thrust our foot on that imaginary brake, it's good for us to know that God's promises to us, the same promises that God made to the people of Israel, all the way forward, have not changed. We might want to take control, reach over and grab that steering wheel or hold on to that bike ride while our brothers or sisters learning how to pedal, thinking that we can take control of whatever the situation is with all our wisdom. But we will find out, as the holiness is revealed to us through whatever situation we're going through, that it's God's wisdom that keeps us moving forward in the right direction. And so our task is to keep looking through the cross, to see what is possible through the learnings and the wisdom of Christ Jesus that's imparted to us. Through God's love for us and the world, God has promised and has given us signs where we have actively participated ourselves in a new way of living, in a new way of being. Maybe, if you will think about it this way, that note that Ben wrote to us this morning, telling us how much he thanks God for a group of people who have the wisdom, the desire, to look at him and other people, not just as another person, but as a brother or a sister, as someone special, as a child of God, who at a particular time needed a particular gift, a lesson in love, not that he may not have known, but we needed to teach. We needed to be that love. We needed to be that place of hospitality. We needed to welcome and encourage him through all his life changes. And this is applies to all of us, that we all need to be, as I said, the Christian educators that embrace brothers and sisters, that whoever comes through these doors, because we're all raw material, that God wants to make holy. Holy at birth, yes, but God continues to want to make us something new. So I pray that as we move forward together, that we'll continue to understand this task that we have, this wonderful task of being the Christians that God so longs us to be the people that the apostles imagined, that we would take these new ways of human existence, of being the church, and we'll never prevent the unwanted situations and circumstances that will come our way, but what we'll be able to do is point forward through them and with hope and joy, knowing that we're never alone. We have one another, of course. Overall, we have God. We are of God, says the letter to the Corinthians. We are of God and are in Christ Jesus. I can't think of any better place to be. I can't think of any better thing to be out of raw material of life. God makes us holy.